Greetings and salutations. Welcome to another edition of Ghosts Are Near, where we discuss various aspects of the paranormal. I'm your host, Keith Johnson. With me are my co-hosts, Sandra Johnson.
Hello.
And Carl Johnson.
Howdy do.
Sandra and I are also the founders of New England Anomalies Research, and I'd very much like to welcome our live audience with us, or as they say in the hills of Sweden, välkommen. And today we have a very, very special guest with us. She is a paranormal researcher and an author, but she wasn't born that way. It was various life experiences led her to this path. And she has written a book, The Other Side, by Denise Jones. The Other Side is about the boy who sees spirits, details the experiences of Denise and her son. And I would like to mention that Denise's son, Michael, is actually the role model for the boy in The Sixth Sense. Although the stories are not identical, the premise is the same. And without further ado, I'd very, very much like to welcome you, Denise Jones.
Thank you.
Hello, Denise.
Hey, guys.
We thank you for driving down here, and I understand you had a good drive.
Wonderful drive.
Good.
Wonderful.
Good.
It got you here.
Yes. So, Denise, this first took you unawares. As I said, you really didn't start out planning to be a paranormal investigator or an author.
No.
And
well, you know, a lot of people think it started when my son was able to see spirits.
Mm-hmm.
But when I was a child, I was so frightened of ghosts that I would leave the doors open so that I could run out.
Really?
I was more afraid what was inside our houses than outside the houses.
Mm-hmm.
It's generational, and my parents both see spirits as well. And they kind of kept it from us, except we would hear some of the stories when they were telling relatives and stuff. You know, we were sneaky kids.
Mm-hmm.
And I was frightened, literally frightened of them.
Mm-hmm.
And I was told it was getting me ready for when I did when I did have my children. And both my children both see spirits. Michael kind of got hit pretty hard.
Mm-hmm.
He has all kinds of gifts, and he sees both good and bad.
Good and bad.
Oh, absolutely.
Unlike the movie The Sixth Sense, where they're pretty generic, they're just basically wandering ghosts that haven't crossed over yet. But it's different with Michael, isn't it, in some ways?
Yeah, Michael seems to get an array of them. He will see the woman in a wedding dress sitting on the bed, to a little boy running around the house, to something evil wanting to choke him.
I see.
And he deals with this on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm. Now, how did this first start? When did you first start noticing that something was going on with Michael that wasn't of the ordinary?
The first time Michael was screaming in his room that somebody was trying to touch him, I kind of ran around the house looking for somebody in the house trying to touch him. You know, I grabbed one of his trucks and I'm running around the house. There was nobody there. You know, in back of your head, you kind of know that this happens because, you know, it happened to me growing up. I just didn't want it to happen. If it was something medically or there was a guy in the house, I could fix that.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't fix this. And so it was kind of horrible for us.
Did it seem to start at a certain age? Was he a certain age where you really started noticing that he's experiencing
When he was able to talk, he would say there was people upstairs whispering, you know, asking who was upstairs in the beginning, and nobody was upstairs. But I think when he was about 4, almost 5 years old, is when he really started having a lot of troubles and letting us know that this person's there, this person. And I think it was my grandfather he saw first.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
It was absolutely my grandfather. He had never seen a picture of my grandfather. He passed when I was about 10 years old. My father takes pictures and epoxies them on wood and sells them at craft shows and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he happened to do this to one of the pictures of his father,
mm-hmm.
so he would keep it forever, put it on his wall, and when we came into his house, Michael and Kenny went to the candy dish, and there was the picture. Michael started screaming, you know, because this is the guy who was trying to touch him.
Right.
So we had to all calm him down and let him know that it was grandpa and he wouldn't hurt him. Mm-hmm.
So because of your own experiences and your childhood, you didn't doubt this. You didn't think it might be due to some form of child psychology, some phase he was going through?
As a mother, you will always think that there's something wrong. I mean, I took Michael to so many doctors, neurologists and eye doctors looking for floaters, and I still did it up until a couple of years ago. I mean, because Michael would have new things go on. He would have visions now, which he has, or he would have be in a paralyzed state where he can't wake up. Yeah. I'd call an ambulance, you know, let them put smelling salt under him. They called in the priest to pray over Michael in the hospital and let us go. But I, you know, as a mother, you just don't know, because everybody has medical issues.
Right.
You know, and something just can come in. So I always have them tested, but I know what it is. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
I suppose there was never a time in your life where you had the luxury of doubting the existence of spirits and, you know, them visiting us.
Right. Were you always a believer, basically, in spirits?
I was always afraid of them, yes. Mm-hmm. I always knew they existed. I remember when I was little, we would hear the wall crack behind the TV. And once you heard this, you knew that they were there, and they would go up the stairs into my room and disappear in my closet. So yeah, I was scared.
To see them go up the stairs?
Yes. And it always seemed to be relatives, you know, when they would pass or something. Yeah.
Kind of like a transition apparition.
Yeah, I would not sleep until my eyes physically closed. Mm-hmm. I was very frightened.
But did they stay there, or they just seemed to be hanging around to say goodbye? Or
those ones would just they would go away. I think they just came to say goodbye. We always lived in a house that had spirits in them. We had an older woman who lived in it. My mother said she never had to, you know, dust or get rid of cobwebs, because she did it.
This was a very conscientious spirit.
We had a housekeeper.
Yeah, I want one of those.
That's neat.
Me too. Wow. It would be nice. Yeah. Well, ours just seemed to break things now, so. Mm. Yeah.
But after reading the book, it seems like things really seem to become amplified with one particular house that you moved into, where things really started picking
Yes,
up
it did. It was one of the houses in Manchester, a blue house that we moved into. It. Michael, I think, was about 6 years old, and we kind of did some research on that house, and it belonged to a funeral director. And there was one entity in that house that just did not want us there. I mean, he was very mean to us. You know, the stove would turn on by itself, things would go across the rooms. One time I was on the couch and it just jumped to people talking on the telephone that didn't exist. I would try to call someone and instead I would get a woman's voice on it telling me once that she just cleaned the sheets and made the beds and you're not going to make me leave.
Really?
Yeah, it was very like a hologrammy kind of sound. My mother would try to call us when she knew that something was going on, and she would try to call. She would get a man screaming no all the time, and yeah, it was weird. Very strange house. But every house is different. We've moved so many times. We've had different spirits in every house we've been into. Michael kind of brings them in, you know, from all around the place. But when you move to a different house, they always have their spirits attached to it that you end up seeing.
And he seems to kind of activate the phenomena in whatever house that
I try to blame him a lot about that. Yeah, I do. Some people say, it's you too. I do have some kind of thing where I attract him as well. Mm-hmm. But Michael is more the beacon, is what I call him.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, yeah.
So I know we've seen that with a lot of our clients where, you know, we'll investigate a house where there is reported phenomena, but yet the prior occupants of the house never experienced anything. It seems to just take the person with the right wavelength to move in to get things started.
Oh, yeah. That's right. I truly believe that. In fact, I'm thinking about selling my house and buying another one. And I'm kind of worried what spirits are going to be there because it's like every house you go into, there's spirits. You know, it's like we're attracted to those kind of houses, I think, as well.
Well, the title of our show is Ghosts Are Near, and
absolutely.
I truly believe that. They are all around us.
Yes, they are.
Spirits that are in an unseen realm, except in the case of someone like yourself or Michael, who do tend to see these entities, and you are aware of them, whereas I think the general populace is not.
Right. Well, it's hard for Michael because he can't understand why no one else sees these things. Mm-hmm. He's seen them, at such a young age, and he would see energy. He would have his hand up, and he would bring it down, and he'd keep doing this. And I'd be like, "What are you doing? You know, right. Michael, what are you doing?" He's like, "I'm looking at my energy. Mm-hmm. Do it." So I'm doing this, and I'm like, "Mike, I don't see anything." He says, "Mom, you don't see your hand still up there when you bring it down, going down in colors?" It's like, mm-hmm. "No." And he was just dumbfounded. He thought everybody saw this.
You mean like an aura?
Yeah, when he goes like this and brings it down, he still sees his hand up there and in slow motion, his hand going down with colors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he just thinks everybody was able to do this. So I let him know that there is going to be things that he's going to be able to see and understand.
Right.
But nobody else does.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Now getting back to the sixth sense, how does the real life story compare to the movie? Now I know the psychiatrist, that was all fictional for the story itself.
Absolutely.
But the true story is actually more the story of Michael and you, right?
Yes. It's and it's pretty close.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Michael had his tent that he felt safe in. He would see things with blood on them.
Uh-huh.
You know, spirits, entities. He was locked into a closet and actually a suitcase from children once. So, yeah, it's pretty close.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. Going down the street when the boy saw the child on the the man on the bike who had passed.
Right.
Michael does that all the time.
Really?
You know, he sees a lot of entities on the side of the road. And at first he had a hard time figuring out if they were really dead or not, mm-hmm. or if they were real
right.
people. But now, as he's older, he understands. He feels it in his stomach. He knows exactly who's passed and who's not. Because some people, to him, look like you or I sitting here.
Mm-hmm.
They'll come to him in
yeah.
full color mm-hmm. and just go talk to him.
But he also gets a physical sensation now along with it, so he can differentiate.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. And when they're not good, he gets very ill, very frightened of them. Mm-hmm.
Tell me some more about the attacks he's experienced from these more malevolent spirits.
Michael's been attacked a lot. I remember one time I was on the phone with my mother, and we're all watching TV, you know, the two boys, and I was sitting there, and Michael just started screaming, and he lifted up his arm, and I'm watching the scratch go down his arm with blood mm-hmm. dripping as it's happening. I think I threw the phone. You know, from my mother, and I ran for holy water, and I kind of jumped on Michael, and I'm trying to protect him, and I remember thinking how horrible it was that I could not protect my son from something I could not see.
Mm-hmm.
I was very upset about it.
And you sought help, didn't you, from those who were supposedly experts in paranormal research and from the church as well?
Yes, I did.
And you had some negative experiences with that?
Yes, I did.
Yeah.
Which did you approach first, the religious?
The religious. I tried, my church turned me down. They kind of were very mean to me.
Really?
I was very heartbroken. I walked out of that church crying. I tried nuns, mm-hmm. I tried everybody. Nobody seemed to want to listen.
They didn't believe you, or they were just unwilling to listen? Or?
They were unwilling to listen, I think. But
you were ultimately able to get a religious group to come into your home and kind of check things out, or
a different religion mm-hmm. decided to come in. But Michael did have a Catholic bishop who performed his first exorcism on him.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Was the exorcism successful?
Absolutely.
Excellent.
Michael was not scratched or hit or poked or anything physical after that for a while.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what nobody seems to understand with Michael, he's a little different, and he does bring in spirits all the time. And when he does have something negative come in, of course you're going to have to get rid of it, but that doesn't mean a month or 2 months down the road doesn't mean he's going to bring something back in
mm-hmm.
on a negative level. And that's what he seems to do. Lately, he's been doing pretty good with bringing in the negative. He knows how to rid of them.
That's good. He's built up a defense.
Yeah. Yes. When he sees one, he just literally lets him tell them, you know, that they're not welcomed.
Mm-hmm.
And so that is a good thing. Yeah. I'm happy about that.
What about angels? He deals with angels as well, right?
Yes, he does. Archangel Michael was someone that he's always called upon to help him with the negative.
Mm-hmm.
And one time I was in my jacuzzi with Michael, and a relative came out and talked to me. And for some reason, Michael had an uncomfortable feeling with this relative at that time. He was in a bad place. And all of a sudden, Michael pointed out to me that Archangel Michael was standing there, and he had his staff, and he pointed it towards this relative. Mm-hmm. The minute the relative went into the house and left, he had brought it back up. And I said to Michael, I said, how do you know that's Archangel Michael? I mean, you know, hello.
Right.
How would you know that? You know, and he says, well, Ma, how can you breathe? Mm-hmm. He's like, I just know. I know these things. And he told me that he was wearing a white cloth that was wrapped around him. He was barefoot. He had long blonde hair, dirty blonde hair, and a huge nose. He said this guy's nose was huge. and he was very tall, so, you know, but he said he knew it was him. And
just knew it was the Archangel Michael.
Yeah, he seems to know things. I don't know where he knows it from. But he did.
Quite a detailed description, though.
Yeah,
he saw something.
Well, he was staring at him while I was out there. I felt I was in a jacuzzi, which is 105 degrees, but yet when he was telling me, I felt very cold. Mm-hmm. It's very hard to describe how cold I felt. And I had goosebumps, so, you know. And then when he left, he just left, and Michael just felt good. And, you know, he's seen him a few times. I talked to my other son, who said he's seen him also a few times, Archangel Michael.
Yeah.
So.
Did your other son describe him the same way?
You know, I don't even think I asked my other son what he looked like.
Yeah.
I just, when I told him about Michael had seen him, he said, oh, yeah, I did a few times, too. Mm-hmm. You know, it's normal. And he's quite gifted as well. But Kenny can control his gifts a little bit more because he has a few of them. Mm-hmm. So when something happens or he feels something negative, like for instance, I was on the phone with him a while ago and he says, Ma, can you hold on a minute? There's something in here. I'm like, okay. And I'm thinking there's a person, mm-hmm. you know, he's in the Marines. Mm-hmm. So I'm waiting. He comes back on the phone. He goes, all right, it's gone. I said, what? And he says, well, something negative came in while I was talking to you. I had to get rid of it. And I was like, okay.
You mean from that distance?
From that distance, I said, okay, and he did. So I was like, all right. So now when something happens with his brother or just in the house in general, I'll call up Kenny and tell him, you know, help us out, you know, send some of your energy our way because we need you. And he says he does, so.
Mm-hmm. Now, you did call in paranormal investigators originally because you had no place else to turn. Little did you know that you would become a paranormal investigator yourself.
Yeah, I wouldn't have thunk that, I'll tell you, because I didn't think I'd be going in a house where there was ghosts. I'd be running out of them.
Right,
but
going looking for them. Yeah.
It's worse in your own house. I figured that one out. But, mm-hmm. Yeah, they didn't work out very well.
Well, they weren't exactly equipped to deal with the level of activity you and Michael and your other son were experiencing, right?
No, actually they were.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they were. I really think they were, but that wasn't their focus on going into my house. Their focus was media.
And wrong motivation.
Wrong, yeah, that wasn't good. In fact, when I opened up the door to all these TV people standing in my front yard, I had found out later that they got a speeding ticket driving there to inform them all. You know, and when I wouldn't sign my rights to my story away to them, you know, I mean, they came into the house and they told me that they were going to write a book and take our names. And so I kind of said, no, I need other help now. And it's as an attorney. And I fixed that situation.
Right.
And I founded the L.I.F.E. Foundation, right, where I have paranormal investigators now throughout the world, where if someone needs help, mm-hmm. I can refer them to somebody who's not going to go in there
and
use them for money or fame. They're going to go in there and help.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm. And L.I.F.E. standing for?
Living in Fair Ends. And that's why you guys are on the foundation.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yep. It's great, I think, when we can all work together for a mutual cause, be like-minded, and yet help such a diversity of people that are experiencing this phenomena and who feel that they have really no one to turn to, as you were in that situation yourself.
Yeah. Well, I get a lot of emails, and the first ones, you know, their first few sentences are always, you're not going to believe me, I'm not crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And usually when I see that, it's like, ah, oh no. You know, then I go through the whole email and I could, I seem to be able to pick out exactly what's going on, or if it's a false email, because you know how we all get those too.
Yeah.
But it's very easy now because I went through it, so I know when they say things, what's going on.
You're familiar with that sense of isolation where you just don't know who to turn to, where are the experts, who's going to help me with this, and you don't want to be
And the fear of being alone all night long while the investigator's home eating dinner or investigating another case.
Right.
And you're sitting in that house scared, you know, staying up so your children go to sleep first, and then you're up alone.
Yeah, and then if you open up to other people, you open yourself to ridicule, possibly.
Yeah, you know, I had gotten a little bit of that. I have to admit, the Skeptical Society did contact me when it was all going down, which they kept lying and saying there were different people to try to get me to the phone.
Oh, right.
Which was really strange to me because I'm not used to that. And then when I finally answered, they did. And when I finally answered the phone and they told me who they were, I asked them, why did you lie? They says, well, I didn't think you'd talk to me. And it's like, why? I'll talk to you. I have nothing to hide. So I sat there talking to one of the head guys from the Skeptic Society. We talked for quite a while. And he thanked me for talking to him and said that I did everything I should have done to prove it wasn't true, you know, that,
right,
you know, taking my son to the doctors and doing everything I could. And then I had the evidence that it was. See, because I ended up filming a lot of Michael going through these things because I thought the doctors might need to see him or somebody.
Yeah.
So I do have that. And they left me alone.
Well, skepticism should go hand in hand with a healthy dose of objectivity.
Absolutely.
Can I ask what you actually got on film?
I have a lot of stuff. I have Michael, excuse me, I have Michael being choked anytime you put holy water or a cross or anything on him. He's in a paralyzed state, and he's literally, you'll see his neck go in, him gasping for air. I also have something that had entered Michael.
Really?
It was not Michael. You'll see his eyes change, and then his eyes will go behind his head, and all you see is white. And this went on for hours. I have a lot of stuff, yeah.
He's actually in a state of possession, would you say?
Well,
or would you refer
some
to
people say that, and you know, I don't know. So, you know, I just don't know, and I really don't want to answer that, if he was or if he wasn't.
Right.
I heard possession, I heard oppression, I heard he was channeling. Now, Michael has all these gifts, where I spoke to someone and they said, what's strange about Michael is he is a psychic medium, clairvoyance, clairaudient. He astral travels, he has visions. He says normally people have one or two of the gifts, but Michael seemed to got hit with all, and Michael couldn't figure out which is coming in to play. So I don't know. I really don't know. But I'm being there, my opinion would be something was in my son. That would be my opinion.
It seems like it would be more, it would more fall under the description of passing possession, maybe we would call it.
Yeah, transient possession.
Possession, because, I mean, it doesn't sound like he had asked to channel this
no,
entity.
No, but being that gifted with Michael, he didn't ask for, God, he didn't ask for any of this. But he didn't ask to go out of body either, astral travel. And Michael would sit there and watch TV. And if he got comfortable and just relaxed, he popped out. So everything was just jumping into him in and out, and he just couldn't figure it out. He would pace the floors trying to get it to stop because he didn't know what else to do.
Wow.
So we don't know. But look, you know, looking back at the tape that I just looked at, of that, well, it wasn't my son that I was looking at, and who was looking at me. He was very evil looking.
So, but the exorcism that was performed over him was very successful, at least temporarily.
Temporarily. Michael's had four exorcisms now. Mm-hmm. And we've had a couple home exorcisms.
Of course, I've met Michael personally, and I've been to your house. And
he says hi, by the way.
Yes.
Well, he loves you.
You tell him God bless. And
I will.
And we're thinking of him, too. And what impressed me was how well put together you all are. I mean, you know, the things you've been through and the experiences you've had, and yet it's such a warm, loving mm-hmm. household. And, you know, in a way, it's typical American family. No,
it was chaotic for a while, I'll tell you.
Yeah.
It's all sleeping in the living room.
But you've lived through it.
But
you know?
We lived through it, and life does go on. We learned a little bit more. I learned for the past 15 years of what spirits are, what they want, mm-hmm. that kind of a thing, and learned not to be afraid of them.
Yes.
That was my number one thing was do not fear. It's
right.
Okay.
Living in fear ends.
And living in fear ends. And you know, I did see my first apparition. I think Michael was 8 years old, and I was down on the computer, and I was working on that book, and this guy, you know, it was funny because I first saw a glance, and I looked, and there was nothing there, and I continued, and then all of a sudden I saw something move again, and I looked, and there was this man, and he was hunched over, head to toe, and he just moving his arms back and forth and just went from my living room into my dining room, disappeared.
Wow.
And I'm sitting there going, oh my God, did I just see this? Wish I had a camera in hand.
Wow. He was just passing through.
And I didn't have one.
Oh my God. Well, believe it or not.
You never do.
Yeah. No.
Well, we've got about a minute left.
Yeah, we're almost out of time.
Yeah, half hour goes by quickly.
I want to thank
yes,
you and God bless you for all you do, Denise. And will you come make a return visit?
I absolutely will.
Because we're just getting started here. You know?
Yes, we
just scratched the surface. Yeah.
Right. Definitely will come back. Absolutely.
Sandra, would you like to share some of our contact info?
Yes, as always, we'd like you to know that we at New England Anomalies Research are available to research local alleged hauntings or assist those of you who may be experiencing unexplained phenomena in your home or place of business. We'd also like to hear from you if you have a show suggestion or even if you would like to be a guest on Ghosts Are Near. So give us all a shout at ghostsarenear@inbox.com. We'll believe you.
Well, this has truly been fascinating, and please do come back again.
I will. Yeah. I'm working on another couple books. So
we can't wait.
Bring them in.
I mean, this book is so fascinating, you could read it in one sitting. So I'm just waiting for the sequels to come out.
The sequel is coming out. I'm working on it with Jason McCurry from Ghost Great. Magazine right now.
Oh, fantastic. Great. Well, that's our show for today. And I'd like to thank you all for joining us. And as always, God bless you. We'll see you next time.
Goodbye.